And I now have the honor to announce Edwin Rush as our first speaker. Edwin, the founding director of the Empathy Center, he is a developer and long-term evangelist of the Empathy Circle practice. Over to you, Edwin. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Ruth, and thank you, everyone else, for being here. What I wanted to do in my presentation is to, I'm going to show a slideshow, and let me get that up on the screen here. If I can share, there we go. And what I wanted to do in this presentation is I want to give you a short overview of how the empathy circle came about. I see this process, which is based on mutual active listening as the core practice of the empathy movement, with active listening being just very fundamental to as a fundamental skill for to learn for fostering empathy. And what I want to do is cover the influences of how the practice was developed, and then all the other presentations will help build on that. So a little bit about me is my interest in empathy started in 2008. I was making some documentaries on different human values, on I was exploring progressive values, and I came across the topic of empathy when I was doing my interviews, and I thought, hey, this is a really an important topic. It's really fundamental to how we relate to each other as human beings. And so I started researching and studying and interviewing and just really learning about empathy through, just kind of through all the research and the interviews. And one of the first people I came across was an academic, George Lakoff, who teaches linguistics at UC Berkeley. And he talked about how empathy is the basis of progressive thought, and it's the basis of progressive family life. And since I was thinking of myself as a progressive at that time, I thought, well, I want to, dig into these progressive values. And he was kind of making the case that empathy was core to progressive values. And I don't think of myself as a progressive currently. I have sort of left the different sort of political views and now really see myself as, grounded in an empathic way of being is a, so. But anyway, at that time, I was very much into just looking at progressive values. And he also talked about empathy as the heart of democracy. And that is, he says, that is what this is all about. Citizens caring about each other. Other citizens and having a government that is of the people and by and for the people. So just seeing that mutual empathy is really the core of democracy. And then around this time as well, Barack Obama was running for office, and he was saying he says, it seems to me like we've got an empathy shortage, an empathy deficit, and it's more serious than the federal budget deficit. And we've become so cynical that it is almost naive to believe that we can understand each other across the gulf of race or class, religion, region, or religion. And so his campaign was very much based on fostering this quality of addressing the empathy deficit, really. And I thought, well, maybe I can also help with that issue as well. Is just really, through all the research and making documentary and so forth. So those were some of the sort of philosophical motivations for my interest in empathy. And also in my teens, I did a lot of traveling. I was a seeker and, traveling around the world for 10 years, sort of seeking the meaning of life. And when I discovered empathy, the value of empathy, connecting with human, fellow, seeing our, connecting with our fellow human beings and seeing our common humanity, it really resonated with, I think, with what I was seeking. So I started learning about empathy practices. I had that sort of philosophical, yeah, empathy is this important value. And in my studying of empathy, I started learning about active or empathic listening. And one of the first people I learned about was Carl Rogers. So Carl Rogers is considered one of the top two or three clinical psychologists in history, for that matter. And in the 1950s, 60s, and 70s, he developed this process he called the person-centered therapy, where he would just listen to people actively, to his clients. And on YouTube, there's this video that you can find where this person, Gloria, there's three different therapists use their different therapeutic approaches with her. And, he used his person-centered therapy, using active listening with her. And you can see a demonstration of how that works. So, and Rogers also really articulated and developed the whole active listening process. He gives credit. He mentions that he had someone that did Ronkian therapy, and that she was the one that told him about when you listen, you kind of look for the deeper feelings that you're listening for, that you're listening when the person is speaking, and that you hear the feelings kind of behind, under the surface of what they're saying, and you reflect. Actively reflect that as well. So, the way this worked is we have person-centered therapy where the therapist actively listens one way to the client. And so they listen for, they're doing the typical therapy is, like a 50-minute session. So, for just 50 minutes or an hour, Rogers would just do the active listening. The speaker would speak and he would just reflect back his understanding. He would not ask questions. He wouldn't give advice. He wouldn't give sympathy. He wouldn't judge them. He would only listen to them actively. And so this really, I started seeing as I did more and more research, seeing that this practice really becomes a foundation for the empathy, creating an empathic way of being. And then I learned about Marshall Rosenberg and nonviolent communication, and it's actually the first group that I connected after I got interested in empathy in the Bay Area. I got connected with the local Bay Area NVC community, and which was the over or NVC for nonviolent communication community. And this organization was developed by Marshall Rosenberg, who was a graduate student with Rogers. And so he learned, the philosophy of empathic philosophy. And this active listening skills, and he built on that and developed a whole community around the tools and practices and mindset that he developed. And so, in his process in nonviolent communication, it's not just a therapist listening to another person; it's anyone can use active listening to listen to another person. So. He taught, in his workshops, he taught how to just in just human relationships, how you could use active listening to speak, to listen to others. And then another influence that I came across in my research about actual practices was Helen Hunt and Harville Hendricks, and they developed what they call imago relationships. And so they again, took this work of Rogers of active listening, and they've put it into relationships. And so they developed a whole tool set for what they call, like I said, imago relationships, and where it's mutual active listening between romantic couples. So when couples, if they're in conflict or even before they're in conflict, they would use active listening to just talk with each other so they could be sure that they really heard each other. And so this is like another manifestation of how people, different therapists and so forth used the active listening process. Then, continuing, as I kind of looked around, I saw that we have in Berkeley, I live in El Cerrito, which is near Berkeley, California. In Berkeley, there's a community mediation center, and they do this 40-hour training. And I took that training, and there again, active listening pops up. So there, if you have a conflict, you're a mediator, people come into the center there to have deal with some conflict. You have a mediator, and the mediator actually uses active listening to speak, to listen to one of the disputants, and then they listen to the other, and it kind of goes, back and forth. They listen to each of the disputants, and that helps the people feel heard, and it kind of really helps to unravel the conflict, and the mediator helps with that. And then another workshop I did, which was very influential, was with Dominic Barter, and he developed something called restorative circles. And this is where you take a circle approach. And he developed this in Brazil. He's from the UK, but he developed it in Brazil. And he says he had a lot of influence from, Marshall Rosenberg and NVC. I'm not sure how much he looked into Roger's work, but he does mention Rosenberg for some influences. So in this process, you have a circle and people who are in, a couple of people who are in conflict. They invite other people into the circle to discuss the conflict, and you have a speaker, and then the speaker selects their listener. And then that listener reflects back their understanding of what the speaker says. And then, like in the empathy circle, when the speaker is done, the listener becomes the speaker, and they select the listener, and then they speak. And I believe there's no time limit, so people can just go on and on. And then it just goes around in the circle like that. And these sessions go 3 hours or more, where people discuss the conflict using active listening, and there's a lot of other steps to it, but I won't go into the other steps to it. Then another influence that I came across as I was kind of researching on the internet was Juanita Brown and David Isaacs. And they developed a process called World Cafe. And in the World Cafe process, they would just bring people together around tables, maybe five people, 4 or 5 people to a table. And they would have a topic that they would discuss in small groups. And they would speak, talk for a little while. And then at some point, people from each table would get up and then go to another table, and they would do this a few times. And it was a way to, just have people discuss with each other, and then for the ideas to shift from one table to the other. So those were just some sort of technologies, practices that I had seen. So as I was doing my research, and then in 2011. Occupy Wall Street happened, and people at Occupy Wall Street and that would say, it's the 99 against the 1%. And I think, I was trying to build a culture of empathy, which I think is 100% empathy. We don't have an us versus them mindset. So I got this canopy, this tent. And set up the empathy tent and took it to Occupy Wall Street in Berkeley, and that was in the fall of 2011, and that was our tent from the other side. Just go there. And a few things I noticed about the dynamics of the of the camp there was a lot of factions and a lot of groups, and they would, were kind of at each other's throats, and there was a lot of conflict. And you can just see the different factions there. And so it was a rather somewhat dysfunctional sort of a community. But in the tent, we did one-on-one listening. So we had an empathy tent member, and a community member would come in, and we would offer listening, active listening to them. And then another practice we tried was talking stick circle, where one person speaks, and then you pass the talking stick, and then another person speaks, and we go all the way around. And I found that that process didn't work too well. I wasn't too happy with that process because one person would just keep speaking and speaking, and I saw everyone wanted to speak. And another structure I saw there was they had Occupy Wall Street. They have the General Assembly where you have one person speak and they speak to the whole group, and different people would get up and speak. But sometimes that was kind of like manipulated, like who would get a chance to speak. So. And then I kind of thought, well, what's a way of really addressing sort of these conflicts that are there? And that's sort of where I had the idea of an empathy circle, sort of combining the World Cafe, but with the active listening. So you'd have small groups using active listening with each other, like in a World Cafe, but one person would speak and the other, would listen, and we'd go around. And then they would maybe go for an hour, and then they would shift, go around meet with other people. And during the day, maybe they would just be a whole day of doing empathy circles because people didn't have much else to do at these camps. But then they closed down the camps, and I never got to really implement, try to develop the empathy circle and sort of idea. And then I sort of just sat on it and on the idea. And then I got connected with Lidewij Niesink, who is someone from the Netherlands that she has a PhD in empathy. And I interviewed her. And then afterwards, she said, oh, let's work together to develop some empathy practices. So we actually got together, and for like over a year, just sort of experimented and really kind of developed the empathy circle practice, and sort of experimented with different aspects to it. And we held this is a oh this is actually go back that's the first recorded empathy circle picture of it with the four of us. And then this was a book club we did with it was like a 10-week book club with different on a book club, we applied the empathy circle practice in 2013. And, we just keep, so we just kept innovating, coming up with different ideas. And then Levi got interested in other projects. And I just kept sticking with the empathy circle. And, another thing that we added too was, not just the empathy circle is just a practice, but also that it has an intention. And the intention is that we want to create a culture of empathy. Because the first website I created was the Center for Building a Culture of Empathy. And it's really about sort of cultural transformation. And then another milestone was in 2020, during the COVID period. Lou Swire and Bill Filler worked with some doctors at a hospital in New York that was overwhelmed. They were dealing with COVID issues, and they developed the core of the Empathy Circle facilitator training, and kept innovating and developing it. And then we were working together, and this is a just a photo of our second Empathy Circle facilitator training, cohort number two. That was in 2020. And so with that, you can see that the Empathy Circle practice keeps developing. We keep adding, more aspects to it, and keep expanding it. And now we're really trying to build the empathy movement with the empathy circle practice, and innovating on it is it's one of the core to the empathy movement. And these are just some of the cohorts that we have held online. I think we've done quite a few of them in the past 4 years or so. And we're holding them in person now here at the Empathy Center in Santa Barbara, and we're planning on holding them in person in the Bay Area, in New York, and in Phoenix as well. And so we, it's you can see this, this basic practice is growing, and our goal is really to teach all 8 billion people in the world how to take part in and facilitate an empathy circle, because it's really an easy first step gateway practice to deepening those empathy skills, and also creating that empathic way of being. And I really believe that this is just an excellent tool, practice, for building that global culture of empathy and nurturing, which will really nurture greater well-being and flourishing in the world. And it's going to be a, it's a long-term project, by, to get all 8 billion people in the world to learn this practice. But yeah, I think it's very doable if we can get high-profile people like, Trump and Harris or so forth to do empathy circles instead of debates. Just one little thing like that could spread it all over the world, I believe, and it can really address a lot of the issues, the wars, and issues, the dysfunction we have in our society in general. So, thank you. Thank you for listening. And it was a lot of fun to it was a lot of fun to create this presentation to articulate the how the history came about. And this is my first iteration. I'll probably refine it a little bit, and then we'll have it out there just for